Good evening, everyone. My name is Cameo Chung, and I'm one of this year's Public Diplomacy Symposium co-chairs. And it's an honor to be here with you today and this evening. The first thing I want to do tonight is introduce the topic a little bit more broadly of what it is this symposium is. The politics of change is the theme of our symposium, focusing on the changing role and the changing field of public diplomacy, particularly in light of recent social and political changes that have gone on around the world. We live in a very dynamic and flexible world, and as it changes, so too must all of the fields involved with those with that world. And when we first conceptualized this panel, we wanted to focus on politics and social change and cultural change, because the field of public diplomacy isn't a stagnant one. It's a very young field, but it's also a field that's very exciting because of that youth, because of the excitement with all of the things that can come from change and adaptation, connecting with people as they grow, as new people come into play. And so we hope you'll enjoy this evening's performance. We are really excited to have Donna Mejia and Dr. William Beeman here with us. And the first thing I'd like to do is introduce Dr. Greg Lambert, the director of the Syracuse University Humanities Center. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome. I have a very small role to play here, which is only to say I'm very pleased to be a part of this, to co-sponsor this this evening's performance as part of a really wonderful 2 days of events in the symposium itself. I'm the director of Syracuse Symposium. The theme of Syracuse Symposium this year is Memory Media Archive. And when they came to me and asked me about co-sponsoring this event, I thought that there was a nice fluidity of the relationship between a performance, particularly dance, as well as the discussion of that continuum that flows into media and different media as part of an archival past, but also the register of a public archive, which is part of what this symposium is about. So I will thank you for coming tonight, and I hope you enjoy the performance.
Thank you, Dr. Lambert. My name is Zhenya Vechininova, along with Cameo Chan. I'm co-chairing this year's symposium. Welcome again. And I have the honor of introducing Donna Mejia. Donna Mejia is a choreographer, lecturer, teacher, and performer specializing in contemporary dance that incorporates the traditions of Arab and African diasporas. Donna teaches, choreographs, and performs an emerging genre of dance that opens dialogues between Arab, African, and nomadic traditions, as well as American contemporary dance. Let's give a warm Syracuse welcome to Donna Mejia.
Oh!
Thank you. That was an amazing and phenomenal performance. And it is my honor right now to have the opportunity to introduce Dr. William Beeman. Dr. William Beeman is a professor of anthropology at the University of Minnesota. He's an internationally renowned expert on the Middle East and the Islamic world, particularly Iran, the Gulf region, and Central Asia. He's conducted research in Japan, India, Nepal, China, and Europe. In addition, he was a professional operatic bass, which we talked about a little bit this evening, and the opportunity to study the performing arts from both the performer side as well as from an observer side, from the audience's perspective. And he's an expert on cross-cultural comparison of theatrical and performance genres. And so I hope you'll all welcome to the stage Dr. William Beeman to discuss the way culture evolves and opportunities to engage in dialogue on that topic.
Thank you so very much, and my goodness, thanks to Donna for the fantastic performance. I think that I couldn't possibly have had a better introduction for my talk than what we've just seen. I'm wondering now how I can get this PowerPoint displayed on the screen. Can I get some tech? Yeah. Oh, okay. There you go. Thank you so much. I want to talk this evening about interculturalism and the relationship between interculturalism and cross-cultural understanding through the performing arts. And it does have an aspect of evolution, which is very important, because humans evolve through the ability to try to deal with new and exciting experiences. And one of the things that human beings learn to do is to experience emotions and emotional change in protected spaces, and the arts provide for this. What is really quite amazing and wonderful about the arts is that, in particular, the live arts, that is, stage arts, music, other things that are experienced live, are indelible experiences for many people. Famous performances throughout the world leave a mark on our existence that remain in our memory for many, many years. And what is also important is that they transcend ideological and political and, in many cases, religious differences. So we're able to communicate in the arts in a manner which, in the words of the philosopher Suzanne Langer, is non-discursive. And non-discursive communication is a very precious thing, a very wonderful thing, that is very hard to achieve. When we when we're able to communicate through the arts, we must train long and very hard. You can see the fantastic and wonderful dance vocabulary that Professor Mejia was able to demonstrate for us this evening. And for those of you who have some knowledge of the dance traditions of the Middle East and Asia, perhaps you could pick up on the elements of her dance that were combined and drawn and recombined in order to make a contemporary performance that was both compelling and extremely beautiful. Well, the cross-cultural contact that we see seems to move in cycles over a long period of time. During crucial periods in world history, we see that contact between different societies was severely restricted due to war or economic difficulties or ideological differences between people. In other words, trade and cultural contact have been free and have flourished widely. Trade and cultural contact have been free and have flourished widely, serving to cross-fertilize human contact. In the period since World War II, and in particular in the last 30 to 40 years, we've seen the beginnings of of such a free period. You know, the psychologist Steven Pinker has told us something that we didn't probably believe to be true, and that is that that human violence has actually decreased in the last 30 to 40 years on a world scale. We hear about the terrible tragedies that take place every day and decry them, but compared with some of the times during the past, period right now, the period of our history right now, is a relatively peaceful period, and the cross-cultural fertilization that's taking place in this period is really quite remarkable. So this is a period of interculturalism. It's been an exciting period, just like similar historical periods have been in the past. And we can anticipate, I think, more to come. The movement has been especially important for the arts. It's a mark of a period of cultural interchange that the most exciting cultural events in any nation seem sometimes to be coming from somewhere else. In New York, we had years ago in the 1980s, the first New York International Festival of the Arts. Maybe some of you are old enough to remember this, 1988. There were 350 events. There were 1,000 performances at 55 locations throughout the city. If you take a look in Tokyo, you see that, or in Shanghai or in Beijing, you see that Western style opera is being performed regularly now in these cities. And Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman, 2-3 decades ago, made a historic debut in China, in Chinese, using Chinese individuals. And we'll see a picture from that a little bit later. Chinese singers are invading Western concert halls, singing Western music, and in Europe and also in the United States. And Korean singers as well, whose vocal technique is very close to the classical vocal technique of the West, are also coming in droves to various places in the West. We have hundreds of music and cultural festivals throughout the world that seemed determined to present the most eclectic performing arts from the widest spectrum of nations and cultures. The effects of this explosion of international music and artistic interchange are widespread. For patrons of the arts, this means a redefinition of the possibilities for artistic expression and understanding. Some of you who are younger may not remember, or you couldn't possibly remember, a time when world music culture was not a part of American society at all. We didn't hear the sounds of the Caribbean or Africa or Asia in our everyday listening mode. I remember one time that there were, this was in the days when we still had vinyl records. I guess they're coming back. But in those days, I remember going to a party one time and having someone put on a party record from None Such Records. That was the Balinese Kechak, the monkey dance in Bali. And we heard this for the first time, and we were all just astonished. What were these sounds coming out of the record player? It was just so amazing. You know, I think you've all heard it by now. I was a part of the vanguard in my undergraduate days at Wesleyan University, which had one of the first world music programs ever. And the world music program had musicians coming from South India, and musicians and a gamelan coming from Indonesia. And I played in the gamelan at that time, but that was exotic. It was so strange. And it was strange for the musicians, too. When we had South Indian musicians coming to the United States for the first time, I remember very well having our South Asian musicians arrive just in time for the annual Christmas concert at Wesleyan, where the chorus was performing Christmas music. And they were excited to hear this for the first time. And remember, this was before people in South India even had regular access to cassettes or radio, to tape cassettes. I'm that old. So they came into the concert hall and sat down, and the chorus began, and their immediate reaction was, because the music is polyphonic, it's polyphony, and it sounded like noise to them. They really weren't used to hearing this kind of music. Now, today, if I were to tell that story, you would laugh at me if I said it happened, you know, last week. That's because that's just how far we've come. People are now more and more used to the artistic and music traditions of other people throughout the world. And as Donna will tell you later, the internet has provided us with an astonishing way to get exposure. You go to YouTube now and you can get anything you want. Any musical tradition, any theater tradition, any dance tradition is available to you now on the internet in order for you to see it or to experience it. Of course, experiencing it live, as I've said to you, is another thing entirely, and it is a very important part of this. Now, there are three principal forces, I think, that have had a particularly strong effect in furthering interculturalism from ancient times to the present day. One is conquest, the second is trade and technology, and the third is the spread of religion. Trade and technology in recent years has perhaps been the most important vehicle for the spreading of interculturalism. These forces, coupled with the dictates of public taste and the inventiveness of individual artists, have been a continual source of dynamic new artistic forms. Human beings are naturally curious about other civilizations. I'm an anthropologist, and I can tell you we are all curious little monkeys. We like novelty. We like new things. The bright, shiny thing in front of us is the thing that attracts us. And we're quick to detect novelty. We know we're easily bored. And we know pretty much when something is new that comes up. So the performing arts that arise in different communities are one of the most visible signs of human cultural difference. So it's no surprise when conditions for contact between human communities are favorable, then different peoples become impressed by the performing arts of others. Theater performance, dance, music, narration could flourish always in foreign territories where they had the added dimension of novelty that they may have lost at home. Accordingly, in ancient times, we have records of performers moving between centers of civilization and providing enjoyment to ever wider groups of appreciative consumers. The poet Ferdowsi, in his epic, the Shahnameh, talks of the Sasanian emperor Bahram Gur, who ordered the importation of 10,000 musicians, dancers, and performers from India during his reign. Another Sasanian ruler, Khosrow Parviz, supported other performers in his court. Now, to cite another form of contact in the East, we can see the introduction of Buddhism, of religion being another important vehicle for intercultural transmission, to China, Korea, and Japan in the exactly the same time period, actually, fostering the transmission of a large body of performance and artistic expression. The principal forms of court dance and religion performance in China, namely bugaku, gigaku, and kagura. Kagura is still performed very widely in Japan in rural areas, have their origins in China and Korea and came to Japan through the Korean Peninsula. However, the Japanese don't like to be reminded of this very often, but nevertheless, it was encouraged by the Japanese rulers during the 7th and 8th centuries AD, in the Common Era, sorry. These in turn formed the basis for the development of better known dramatic forms today, such as no and kabuki. This period in the history of Asia was one of unusually free commerce and travel. It was an important factor which allowed the transmission of these artistic traditions. During the flourishing of Islamic civilization in the 7th century through the 16th century in the Middle East, we have another important cross-fertilization of artistic traditions throughout the region. Trade between Arabia and Southeast Asia was likely the origin of the introduction of shadow puppets into the Middle East. And this is Karagöz from Turkey, or Araöz in Egypt, and also Karagöz in Greece. So you have these shadow puppets who became very popular in the Ottoman court, and there was actually a court position during the Ottoman court of puppet master. And here's the East Asian wayang kulit from Indonesia, and the puppet master behind the screen with his giant shadow puppets. I hope all of you have a chance someday, if you haven't already, to see one of these performances, because they are really terrific. Now, improvisatory comic theater also spread throughout the region. We know through the inspection of contemporary comic forms that there's a continuous comic tradition that existed from Turkey to India involving a central clown figure. This comic tradition seems to have affinities with other East Asian forms, such as wayang kulit, and perhaps even with a Korean masked comedy where there's a clown. We can't prove these things because there is no documentation. And travelers who traveled through these regions and looked at these improvisatory comic traditions would frequently say things like, "Tonight we saw a funny performance with some rude humor." That's all they tell us. They don't give us any details. So for those of us who are interested in the transmission of theatrical tradition throughout Asia, this becomes a very difficult thing to trace. But it's also likely that this comic improvisatory tradition was the basis for European commedia dell'arte. Commedia dell'arte first appeared during the Renaissance in the seaport areas of Italy. And the most probable explanation for its origin is through importation from the East over trade routes linking Europe with Istanbul, especially through Venice. Commedia was able to flourish because of the patronage of the wealthy merchant princes of Europe during this time, who were also invested in trade. Now, in more modern times, we have the opening of the Far East, which has influenced the West in other directions. The opening of Japan in 1856 to trade from the West to the West after 3 centuries of isolation created an unprecedented curiosity about things Japanese. There were Japanese exhibitions in England, later being the one of the results being the Gilbert and Sullivan operetta, The Mikado. But also Russian theater specialists came to Japan to see the Japanese traditions, the kabuki stage. And it's thought that much of the stage machinery that we find in the that we find during this period of time, in particular the revolving stage, may have been borrowed from the kabuki stage. And you can see what the kabuki stage has done with all of the traps, the hanamichi, the revolving stage, and platforms at the back. It's a really terrific art form. In the 20th century, World War I and World War II served to prevent extensive cultural contact between the East and the West. But following World War II and the end of the Vietnam conflict, there's been an explosion of interculturalism in the arts. And it may be reasonably argued that the avant-garde throughout the world has depended on the borrowing of these artistic conventions from other cultures. In the historic past, patronage for the arts, patronage of the arts was of two sorts. There were highly refined artistic traditions that were generally supported by the wealthy. In most of Europe and Asia, the wealthy were generally nobility that were attached to royal courts. This included Europe. And some of you may know that the most that 80% of, for instance, all opera is produced in German-speaking countries. And one of the reasons is that Germany was divided up into teeny little principalities, and each prince had to have their theater, and each theater had to have its own opera company. It was a hallmark of their refinement as royalty in Europe. But the Middle East, Indonesia, India, China, Korea, and Japan all had retinues of artists and performers who inspired not only the tastes of the court, but also influenced public tastes as well. Wealthy merchant princes sometimes served the same function during the period as in the European Renaissance. The Industrial Revolution, or the late Tokugawa, or early Meiji periods in Japan, where trade became a dominant mode. The second system of support was public in nature. The general population of these countries would provide popular patronage for the performing troops, who would support themselves by entertaining at festivals and celebrations or by direct contributions from the public. And I note that that the Syracuse Opera is producing Tosca this weekend. Please all go. And if you do go, you can expect a letter from the opera company hoping that you will make an additional contribution to their effort so that this public support for the arts can continue. We have a very important and interesting economic law, which we call Baumol's Law. Baumol's Law basically states things that cannot be made more efficient relative to other things in a society or to other institutions in society must of necessity become more expensive. And the performing arts are first and foremost in this area. They must become more expensive because we cannot make them more efficient in terms of their outreach to other people. The Metropolitan Opera has done pretty well by having high-definition projections in movie theaters and has thus made their performances more efficient. But they tell you that nothing beats actually hearing the live performance in an opera house, and I recommend that to you very much. In the more popular traditions, the impetus for travel sometimes came from the performers themselves, who would continually try new venues for their art. Sometimes they'd end up chasing money. For instance, the government of the Netherlands is well known for supporting the arts to a terrific degree. And so conceptual artists in the United States, musicians, people who had unusual things to offer, would oftentimes try to find a way to perform in the Netherlands in order to be able to support their art. They'd find that these new populations were delighted with their relatively novel and unfamiliar art and would pay to see and hear it. This discovery would then embolden them to travel even further afield And we do get touring companies from all over the world who travel and who make have quite enthusiastic audiences for their novel performances. The attraction of these aesthetically novel elements in the arts provides an impetus which creates a situation that's favorable to support this intercultural enterprise. Patrons, noble and humble, are revitalized and culturally refreshed through the opportunity to see and experience a new virtuoso dance form, a talented comic performer, or a mystifying set of magic tricks or gymnastics. So in modern times, modern royal patronage has been replaced by governmental sponsorship and foundation support. In the United States, the National Endowment for the Arts, pitifully underfunded, by the way, the Smithsonian Institution, and the Asia Society, among others, have all served to bring performers to new audiences in different cultural settings. There are venues, theaters such as La Mama, ETC, in Experimental Theater Company, ETC, in New York City, that was headed by the late and great Ellen Stewart, the MacArthur Genius Award winner, was one of the important venues that emphasized international performance in their as a venue for arts. Ministries of culture and information in other nations have generally sponsored cultural interchange programs which have brought Western arts into Asian settings. Of course, the most potent force for bringing arts to the rest of the world has been commercial television, film, and now the internet, which seems ubiquitous. Now, the most dramatic changes seen in the artistic traditions in the past years have occurred in the artistic output of the performing artists. Decades of the 60s and 70s brought unprecedented curiosity in the West concerning cultures of other nations. Trade between the East and West began to increase exponentially during this period, and nations such as India, Korea, Taiwan, and Thailand began to emerge technologically as advanced nations with highly visible cultural traditions. Western performing artists began to feel the stagnation of their own artistic traditions. Peter Brook, the British director who just retired, was a singularly important figure in this area. His book called The Empty Space, which I hope some of you have read, points out that theater in the West had become a museum where spectators remained unmoved and unaffected by what they saw on stage. It had become deadly, in his words. I mean, you can agree or disagree with him, but he contrasted this with the performing traditions of Asia, where these were communal activities which engaged their audiences in vital and meaningful quasi-ritual performances. Jerzy Grotowski, the Polish director, likewise, in his book, Toward a Poor Theater, which again I recommend to all of you, likewise extolled this kind of simple, elementary staging that characterizes the traditional theater of much of Asia in order to emulate and in pursuing new artistic depth in the West. Now, Brooks' own activity deeply affected his contact with the arts of Asia and the Middle East. I was actually part of this. I was in the 1970s. I worked in Iran for the National Iranian Radio Television and for the Festival of Arts in Shiraz, which went on for many years and which was a venue for bringing the arts of Asia and the contemporary arts of the West together. Among other things, one year we staged the complete works to date of the composer Karlheinz Stockhausen, and that was a very interesting experience for for the Iranian audience. If you don't know Stockhausen's works, I suggest you go to YouTube and listen to a few. You'll see that they're quite challenging even for a Western audience. His production of the Midsummer Night's Dream was directly influenced by Iranian traditional improvisatory theater, which he had seen in Iran. He was likewise deeply affected by Iranian ritual drama called Tazieh, and also Indian forms such as Ramlila and Kathakali, which he saw at this festival and later in his travels to India, inspired him, as did the Indonesian wayang kulit and topeng. He began to use masks To adopt the stage conventions of the more traditional theatrical forms, such as, for example, his widely celebrated production, which was called La Tragédie de Carmen, which was based on Bizet's opera Carmen, but used essentially the traditional staging techniques of Asia. It's a little bit hard to see this. Many of the pictures that were taken of this production focused on the individual actors in close-up. But this is done in an arena stage, much as much of Asian theater is done, and with people very much up close to the stage, a lot of people sitting on the ground in order to be able to see this this production. There are rings of red ochre in this production, which are important in magic and funeral rites throughout the world, and they surround these rings of red ochre surround Carmen's fortune-telling cards as they're laid out. And there are votive fires and more red ochre, which are lit during the love scene between her and Don Jose. Now, Brooke has brought Eastern stories to the stage as well. The medieval mystic Persian writer, Feridun Attar, in his Parliament of the Birds, Mantegal Tayr, which is a wonderful mystic story, was brought to the stage, as well as the 9-hour production of the Mahabharata, which I was very privileged to see at in Brooklyn, at Brooklyn Academy of Music, when it was staged in New York City. And it really was 9 hours long. You went there early on a Saturday morning, and you got out and got out late at night with a break for lunch. But it was a terrific performance that was used modern Western directorial techniques, but the sensibilities and the structures of Asian theater in order to be able to do this. Now, in all of his intercultural performances, Brooke is attempting to extend the vocabulary of the theater. And this is one of the important points here, is that when you can only imagine what you can imagine. And when you have an intercultural contact between people in the arts, it extends your imagination. Suddenly, there are new tools to work with. There are new sounds to work with. There are new staging conventions to work with that had never occurred to you before. It sparks the imagination and creates a cultural fusion, which is new and can be very exciting. And then it affects the spectators by involving them in new ways. Other Western directors have made attempts to include non-Western performance traditions in their work with excellent results. Grotowski, I mentioned already. Andrzej Szerban was chair, I don't know whether he still is, of the theater department at Columbia. Richard Schechner, at New York University. Robert Wilson, Elizabeth Swados, Eugenio Barba, the great Brazilian director, and Tadeusz Kantor, the late Polish director, are among the most prominent of these. Those of you who've read your theater history will know these names very well. In Asia, a similar fusion of Western and Eastern performances has also taken place, and you find Japanese directors taking Western material and placing it in a Japanese frame. Here's the director Tadashi Suzuki's production of the Bacchae by Euripides. So this is Euripides' production, but in a totally Japanese setting. And you see the head of the king having been ripped off by one of the bacchantes in the Bacchae. In New York, we mentioned the festivals that have been taking place in so many countries, and these do continue down to the present. Now, for the people of the country of origin, an exported performance or artistic tradition, a recognition of the native artistry by a wider audience can be a broadening experience. Often the traditional arts in a particular country are ignored or thought of to be of little value because they're so ubiquitous. They're around all the time. And this is particularly the case with regard to rural and folk traditions. But oftentimes, urban sophisticates believe that their nation's folk traditions have completely died out when they are still alive and viable. I can tell you this from personal experience. You go and you say, where are the performers of such and such a tradition? And the people in the cities will say, oh, I mean, maybe my grandfather knows about that, but there aren't any anymore. They're all dead. And then you go out into the country areas, and they're still alive. They're still there. And it's very exciting when you're able to find these living traditions still going on. But other urban sophisticates don't see the artistic merit in these traditions, largely because they're so seemingly commonplace, as I mentioned. Even Western nations are not immune to this feeling. For instance, I'll bring you the example. Western style professional wrestling, which is an excellent performance form, I want to tell you. something that more than one anthropologist has studied. We've got a lot of books about professional wrestling in anthropology. But it's disdained by the supporters of high culture in the United States, but in fact is widely appreciated abroad. And so you'll find Western style professional wrestling, for instance, being staged in West Africa because it's exciting and it's fun. It's staged, of course, but nevertheless, it is. I think it's an indigenous American art form and a very important one. So recognition of the artistic merit of performance traditions by an international community can then cause people in a country of origin to look upon their arts in a totally new light. In India, which has hundreds, if not thousands, of performing traditions, travel by traditional performing troupes to international festivals has resulted in unprecedented attention at home. Chau, which is a dance form in Bihar in India, which is one of the poorest areas of India, but it's also found in West Bengal and in Orissa, had nearly died out as an art form before it was presented to an international audience. Now, its practice is subsidized by the Indian government and it's presented regularly in concert in India and has been revived largely through its exposure on the international market. So the international attention can have some detrimental sides as well, I've got to point out. Some traditional arts lose their charm and maybe even lose their form when they're presented abroad and regularized to conform to Western tastes. There's a tendency to sort of clean up these performances by increasing their pace, by eliminating slow or redundant sections, rehearsing parts of the performance which were traditionally improvised in order to meet some imagined performance standard of the West. And these supposed improvements in the artistic forms oftentimes serve to destroy them by cutting them off from their artistic roots. So that's a cautionary tale. It's very important to note that. However, presenting traditional arts in a foreign cultural setting also provides a boost for the cultural sensibilities of the people in the country of origin, increases their pride, and revitalizes the arts in general. The normal course of development of appreciation for a totally new performance form is gradual acceptance, starting with a small community of curious or appreciative audience members. If there is a general acceptance at a level which allows the performance to be repeated or given elsewhere, the size of the audience will grow. In nations with large multicultural populations, the ethnic community of the foreign performing troupe may provide much needed attendance and support for the initial performances. At times, persons from this ethnic community will attend enthusiastically a performance. In fact, they never would have attended in their ethnic homeland. I don't want to pick on the Indians, but Gujaratis are well known for this. Gujarati merchants are generally considered to be rather hard-headed and not very culturally sensitive, but they also have money. And so when you come to the United States and you have an Indian performing troupe coming to a large urban area in the United States where there are Gujarati businessmen, like, for instance, the Silicon Valley in California, the Gujarati businessmen show up enthusiastically and support these performances, some of which they had never seen before in their homeland, which I find amusing. But It is something that is that reminds them of home, and it also is a fine artistic tradition. So in the United States, the performing arts of other nations often find it difficult to be commercially viable outside of large urban centers. Tours to college campuses like Syracuse throughout the nations have provided a broader audience for unfamiliar performance forms. Oftentimes, cultural departments of the embassies of the troops, countries of origin provide financial and logistic aid for such tours. Now, in the countries of Asia, Western arts are commercially more viable, and they are presented oftentimes without need of subsidy. The major classical and popular performers of the United States and Europe oftentimes develop a large international audience through recording, television, film, and media publicity. Their reputation oftentimes precedes them when they go into these countries. I remember when he was alive, the German baritone leader singer Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau came to Tokyo to give a concert, and he was practically given a ticker tape parade in Tokyo. There were thousands of people out on the streets waiting to hear him, to have him when he came from the airport, you know, cheering and screaming as if he were a rock star. And I bet you that a lot of you in the audience don't know who Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau is, but he's one of the greatest singers of German lieder, of German art songs that ever existed. And he was greatly, greatly appreciated in Japan. I was once prevailed upon to give a concert of popular songs in Tokyo. And I said, well, what would the audience like? And the people who were producing this, they were the directors of a large department store in Tokyo. And many of you who've been to Tokyo know that department stores frequently have theaters on their top floor, you know, where they have cultural performances. It's a kind of a way to get people into the store, among other things. They have to go all the way through the store in order to get to the top, and one hopes that they buy things on the way in and out. But nevertheless, they do sponsor really wonderful cultural performances. So the department store management said, we'd like you to give a concert of George Gershwin and Kurt Weill. So I said, that sounds wonderful, but what in particular? It's a long, you know, big repertoire. What in particular would you like me to sing? Do you have a favorite Gershwin song or a favorite Kurt Weill song? He says, oh, I've never heard them. And I said, how did you decide on George Gershwin and Kurt Weill? And he said, because nobody knows them. So I thought, well, this is silly. I mean, well, I said, okay, I'll do it. You know, I mean, why not? And so we got an accompanist. We rehearsed the thing, and I thought, well, you know, then maybe 10 people will come, and we'll just have a pleasant evening. I'll just sing a few little intimate songs. This was a 500-seat theater, sold out, completely sold out, and nothing I sang, I think, was familiar to anybody. I had a version of Swanee in Japanese, which I sang, which everybody loved, and they and they loved everything else as well, and I was totally unprepared, however, for this reception, and the applause was deafening. And the manager came out all smiles, and he said, you have honored us with your concert. And I said, well, nobody knew anything that I was singing. And he said, yes. There was a celebrated production, as I mentioned to you earlier, of Death of a Salesman in Shanghai, and it was hailed as a major unusual cultural event. The first production of an American playwright in Chinese, in a Chinese setting. Now, their attention to the arts of other natures, of other nations by major cultural figures will oftentimes increase the popularity to the population in general. The adoption of the Beatles, of Indian musical instruments, in particular the sitar, made these materials far more acceptable to the West and touched off a keen interest on the part of young people to learn more about Indian musical performance. And so I want to conclude here for you and give you a little bit of theory. A distinction can be made between the presentation of traditional arts in their pure form and the artistic synthesis of traditions from different cultural origins. The former I would like to talk about as a first stage interculturalism, and the latter as second stage interculturalism, and I can posit a third stage as well. Separate from both of these are the civilizational and cultural effects that these activities produce in the wider society. Eventually, the success of all of these activities depend on the human ability to perceive universal elements within artistic diversity. So, first stage interculturalism of the arts is the inevitable universally observed product of human civilizational contact. It's spurred on by increased trade or political or religious expansion. So the presentation of exotic or novel arts in these new contexts satisfies a basic human need for aesthetic refreshment in life. Unfamiliar arts may be too outré for many persons, but they usually find a small audience that grows over a long period of time. Eventually, artists who continually are on the lookout for novel materials may become aware of the possibilities inherent in these unfamiliar artistic traditions and initiate second stage interculturalism by incorporating these possibilities in their own work. There are great benefits for artists in enlarging and refining a new scope of their art through contact with other performers and artists. New techniques and conventions of presentation that are learned through cross-cultural exposure may revive a moribund artistic career or provide a fresh channel for artistic vision. Because they draw on multiple basic traditions, they also have a greater possibility of reaching a wider audience. For example, the work of Peter Brook, which I mentioned before, has not only been presented in the United States, but it's also been presented successfully throughout Asia and Africa. He did a tour of North Africa, of La Tragédie de Carmen, which he had developed in Paris, presented in the United States, and then took on tour to Africa. In fact, it wasn't just North Africa. He also did a production of the same thing in Nigeria with great success in an open arena outdoors. Support for both the presentation of new artistic material and for experiments in artistic synthesis is healthy for any culture. Patrons of such activities share a creative role with the artists, enabling artistry to take place. And the mass public of both the nations of origins and the nations where the arts are performed also benefit. The former gain a new sense of pride for their cultural traditions, and the latter are able to have their artistic and cultural horizons greatly expanded. Furthermore, it becomes easy for people in the country where these new traditions are presented to say to themselves, if they can produce this art, well, maybe we shouldn't think so negatively about them. And because the performance is non-discursive and indelible and sits in the memory, the positive nature of that experience can remain for a long period of time. So first stage interculturalism creates a greatly improved atmosphere of a cultural understanding. Once groups of people are able to share a meaningful aesthetic experience, they soon find that they have many other things in common about which they can talk. And the communal feeling that takes place draws on the universal cultural elements present in an artistic tradition. Elements as simple as rhythm, color, movement, and emotional depiction can transcend barriers of language and social difference. Much can be forgiven of a people with whom political or economic tension exists if one can appreciate the greatness of their artistic tradition. Now, this isn't live performance, but think to yourselves about all of the negative things that are said about Iran, then think about Iranian film and how powerful and important the artistic experience of Iranian film is. The same may be true about second stage interculturalism. And let me show you Tazieh. Tazieh is a ritual drama in Iran that I have written quite a lot about this. I have, in fact, a new book called Iranian Performance Traditions that I would, of course, recommend to all of you. But the taziyeh is an entirely indigenous Iranian theatrical form that predates any Western contact with Western theatrical traditions. And in taziyeh, it takes place in an arena. The good characters are dressed in green, the bad characters in red. The good characters chant or sing their lines, the bad characters declaim their lines in stentorian tones. Yo, Hussein! Like that. Now, in a first stage performance, taziyeh was brought to Lincoln Center in 2002. For six performances during the Lincoln Center Festival in the summer of 2002. It was staged in a gigantic circus tent, and the arena was recreated. Taziyeh is one of the few theater forms where actors have to be able to act on horseback, which they do on a regular basis. The performances in New York sold out completely, and one of the most dramatic audience situations was a whole half of the arena was sold out to one group, and it turned out to be a group of Hasidic Jews from Crown Heights. Almost 500 people came to see this performance, and they were totally moved. In taziyeh, one is supposed to cry for the for the protagonist as they're murdered, as they're killed. And the Hasidic rabbi, the leader of the group, said, "We came here because we were afraid that this would be an Iranian performance and it would be anti-Semitic." He said, "We loved it." He said, this is about good and evil. This is about justice. And it was important for us to see it. Now, taking taziyeh to the second stage, we recently produced in Minnesota. I was the producer, in fact, of a version of the Arabic classic "Hay Ibn Yaqsan" by Ibn Tufayl. If any of you were raised in the Arab world, you may have read this. This wonderful classic work. This was the work that inspired Robinson Crusoe by Daniel Defoe, who read this in a translation in his day. And it is about a man, Hay Ibn Yaqsan, who is born out of a slurry of mud and is raised by a deer and eventually discovers all of nature and all of human anatomy and animal anatomy through his independent investigation. And it was staged in taziyeh style, and it was a dance drama. I'm sorry, I wanted to be able to show you a little bit of it this evening, but we couldn't make the connection. But I'll be glad to give anybody who wants to see more of it an idea, a link. Now, if we're talking about these first and second stage interculturalism, we also might talk about a third stage of interculturalism, and that's when things become so incorporated that they become part of the vocabulary of the audience, the target audience. Who would have thought that we'd have jazz sitar, but we do. And there are not a few jazz sitarists around. The ubiquitous spread of hip-hop throughout the world is another case in point. We have so many students who want to study hip-hop at the University of Minnesota, we could practically have a department of hip-hop studies. There's Mongolian hip-hop, there's Burmese hip-hop, there's Hmong hip-hop, there's Thai hip-hop, there's Moroccan hip-hop. Everybody does it. And it's a form that now has become completely incorporated into the artistic traditions of everyone, and without even a second glance. And we get things like this. This is Kehan Kalhor, in the middle with a kemanche, a wonderful Iranian instrument, playing with the wonderful string quartet Brooklyn Rider, in a performance that's largely improvisatory, but uses contemporary music in conjunction with Iranian improvisatory music, and this is the kind of thing that we see in the concert hall, that is really quite wonderful. And the people seeing Kehan Kalhor, Brooklyn Rider already has a very, very well-established audience of people who like contemporary music. They, for instance, have recorded all of the string quartet music of the composer John Cage, and are as well as, you know, the traditional classical string quartet composers. So they show up in a concert with Kehan Kalhor. And the audience doesn't know quite what to make of this. And then they hear Kalhor playing with Brooklyn Rider, and they say, my goodness, this Iranian music is pretty interesting. And then it increases their attention to the artistic tradition. And one hopes that it affects their universalist attitudes toward Iranian civilization as well. My final example is one that I like very much. This is Suleiman Albasa from Kuwait, who produced an Arab version of Richard III, of Shakespeare's Richard III. And it was recast to take place in the Arab world. And you can see how Richard III might have, the story of Richard III might be quite okay, in an, culturally okay, in an Arab familial setting. After all, it's about an uncle who does away with the kids in order to be able to take over the family. And this was played with great success throughout the Persian Gulf. It was sponsored and underwritten by the United Arab Emirates. It played in Bahrain, I believe. And it was, and also in New York, where it was a great success, and throughout Europe. So this is another example of cultural fusion. And when people see something like this, they say, a Kuwaiti theater director doing Shakespeare? Is that possible? And look, it's an Arab story. And it's one that everybody can relate to. So I think that finally it should be emphasized once more that we are fortunate to be living in an historical period where interculturalism is a thriving enterprise. The nations of the world are moving away from a view, I hope, of international relations in terms of great powers and lesser powers. Although in this election campaign, I still hear people talking about American exceptionalism to my great dismay. But I'm still optimistic that we'll overcome these very narrow parochial views of ourselves in relation to the rest of the world. And I hope that we'll see in the future that the interdependency of nations is more important than splendid cultural isolation between nations. Now the arts, I hope I've convinced you that the arts have a tremendous role to play in this process. And as long as nations recognize this fact, then the prognosis for international understanding is going to be that much greater. So thank you very much for your attention tonight. I think we're going to have a dialogue later with Professor Mejia, and so we'll probably take questions at that time. Okay? Oh, you want me to sit down now? Okay.
Will you please treat yourself to a stretch? Stand up, move your body, and resituate yourself comfortably. Thank you. Thank you so much.
So thank you so much for being here tonight, and thank you for your marathon. It's much appreciated. The presentation that I'm about to give is just a portion of a larger study that was conducted in 2011. So I'm going to try and condense and be brief so that you don't have to continue your marathon. And that way, if you have questions you'd like to ask, we can get on to the good stuff. But for those of you who saw the dance performance tonight, I'm sure you have questions about representation, about gender, about cultural references, and about many things. And so what I'd like to do is launch right away into what brought me to being in that dance form and what I have learned from being a part of the dance community. The dance landscape and popular movement culture changes perpetually, we all know that, but there is this new genre that has emerged and it perplexes, to be honest with you. It's called tribal fusion, and it is a dance form that dialogues the secular dances of North Africa and the Arab world with American hip hop and experimental electronic music. This unique aesthetic of tribal fusion celebrates small, micro movements of the torso, nominal use of space, rituals of human adornment and pageantry, and literal transference of music into the dancing body. It was developed in the USA by referencing and sometimes pillaging the influences and vocabulary of dances outside of our nation. Thus, it is steeped in much controversy around issues of Western agency, cultural imperialism, and perceived cultural pollution. Despite this complex and very vexed origin, the genre continues to attract worldwide participants by the tens of thousands annually, most of whom are not intimidated by cross-cultural exchange or concerns with sacrosanct cultural territory, which is something we'll discuss in a moment. Additionally, the form was popularized on the female form and presents a myriad of questions around gender representation and post-feminist considerations. As a genre of transnational dance, tribal fusion is rich with intertextuality. I would bargain that 90% of us in this room could Google our current city of origin or residence with the phrase tribal fusion and find a practice group within your respective community. But yet, we're still under the radar very much of the commercial dance world. The most immediate and fascinating consideration is to be clear that this genre might not exist without the internet, and is arguably the first dance tradition to be impacted aesthetically, directly, and deliberately by internet usage. It is a lens through which we can examine how humans engage technology and how that engagement may be changing enduring human traditions such as dance. Transnational dance practitioners are a self-identified group of artists who deliberately search out inspirations and cultural influences beyond the historical categories or political borders of their home culture. And as a community, they formulate a fast-moving global exchange of music, dance, and expressive artistry that has grown in international reach since the 1980s. Devotees have a distinctly pluralistic approach to making movement and art. I began following the development of tribal fusion in 1999 because I found the movement astonishing. The punctuating accents that erupted from dancers' bodies and torsos made me feel as if we had acquired new junctures and joints. Rhythm was depicted through muscular thrust, pinpoint punctuations, cascading volleys, and ping-pong-style energy bouncing through the torso, unbelievable suspensions and freezes. Every little part of the music was rendered visible on a dancer's body, as if sound was exploding into a multidimensional representation beyond what I had experienced in other dance forms. The dancers were regal, and their joy compelled me. I dove very deeply into discovering this world, both online and in real-time gatherings, and was taken aback to learn that this was already a very huge subculture. Regional conventions, international practice groups, music labels dedicated to remix experiments, entrepreneurs vending fabrics, jewelry from Pakistan, Morocco, Egypt, India, and Turkey. This community has now grown to become my choreographic home, serving as the foundation for my scholarship and my choreographic interests. So what is tribal fusion? What does it pull from? It is really rooted in an abstraction of dances from the secular Arab world. And the genre has broadened and had other influences introduced, specifically the dances of the Ram people from India to Europe, classical Indian forms, Kathak, Odissi or Odissi, Bharatnatyam, Spanish flamenco, Russian, French, and American ballet, because there are many derivatives of ballet in there, North and West African regional forms, and American hip-hop and its subcategories, dubstep, finger-tutting, goth, dark fusion, liquid, micro, phase. Do you know what any of these are? I know, it all changes so quick, I can't keep up with it myself. And contemporary American and postmodern dance. So I'd like to show you a few interpretations of the form. You're all gonna try that stomach flutter tonight. You know you are. You know you are. The audio is compromised on this one. Gonna leave all the fancy things, all the attention that it brings. Tell me no, I'll take. San Diego. Absolutely. I know they're not even here and we're clapping. It's so amazing. So this is the beautiful community that I have come to regard as home. And honestly, I couldn't help but ask the question, what is going on here? It became the resident squatter in my very preoccupied mind, To complicate things further, ever present in this mix was the tribal fusion value to actualize in movement the increasingly industrial, non-human sounds that digital production centralized as an aesthetic value. The most celebrated dancers were able to follow each computer-generated blip, click, glitch, stutter, and slide that producers inserted into their songs. In truth, the dance reads as only an abstraction of the signature elements of popular dances of the Arab world. And the ship since then has sailed far out to sea. And there will be things that will fascinate you when you see the dance form, and things that may be off-putting. And quite honestly, all of those responses are welcomed. I don't expect everyone to completely embrace and understand, but I do appreciate your willingness to watch and to receive. And ultimately, I always use this dance form to help initiate a broader discursive conversation about differences and about perception and about cultural representation. The word and the moniker tribal fusion is really questioned as perhaps not the best descriptor of the dance's identity. Originally, tribal-style Middle Eastern belly dance was introduced to the United States in 1970 by Jamila Salimpour, and later it was influenced and popularized by artists such as Carolina Naricchio, Masha Archer, Patty Farber, Ibrahim Farah, and John Compton, who just passed away this week. As trends grew, one could observe evidence of tribal fusion cross-pollinating other mediums such as film, fashion, modern dance festivals, and American academic discourse. Although demographic data about tribal fusion participants has not been secured yet, as an embedded artist, I observe the majority of community participants to be interested in novel ways of moving, and fellowship for their international interests, which are usually unsupported by their immediate circle of family and friends. Participants are willing to spend significant discretionary income on costuming and instructional classes, so this indicates a fair level of economic privilege that warrants future study. Additional public markers of community membership and embedding include pilgrimage to national or regional dance festivals, intensive study with the cash of elite instructors, investment in performance attire and costumes, sponsorship of regional events serving as a gatekeeper for other participants, possession of merchandise such as convention t-shirts or performance DVDs, and the possession of or following the music of labels and artists that are transnational in their production of electronic music, groups such as Solace or Beats Antique. Certification in a trademark technique of industry instructors of historical note and study abroad in an Arab country. Regular study sessions on YouTube. YouTube is now the largest dance archive in the world. Visual scrapbooking on social networks such as MySpace, Tribe.net, and Facebook.com. Blogging or video journaling about one's journey in dance. Subscription to e-zines, membership in a regional performance group. And ultimately, and not necessarily compulsively, but usually, body modification, tattoos, or permanent markings of some kind. And on the maturing spectrum of cross-cultural proficiency, a growing number of transnational dancers may have extensively studied at least two or three genres of classical study: Iranian, Egyptian, Algerian, Balkan, Indian dance. These participants actively consider the issues of appropriation, privilege, and cultural preservation in their fusion choices. There is certainly an abundance of fanciful, unexamined, orientalist, and caricatured projections in the arena too. But there are participants who are deeply studied, and a growing number are informed by their own multi-ethnic heritage background or second or third generation descendancy from immigrants. A small number of touring professionals possess training in ethnomusicology, anthropology, choreological analysis, sociology, cross-cultural compositional structures, multilingual capacity, and digital technology proficiency. The unique aesthetic of tribal fusion celebrates these small, small, small movements. And so it's very obvious that it takes a downshift in traditional technique study, the ability to move small muscle groups in the body, layered deep, close to the bone, and it definitely is a different approach to training. I would like to share with you a quote from Michael Laguerre, offering his definition of what a virtual or digital diaspora is. By virtual diaspora, I mean the use of cyberspace by immigrants or descendants of an immigrant group for the purpose of participating or engaging in online interactional transactions. Such virtual interaction can be with members of the diasporic group living in the same foreign country or in other countries, with individuals or entities in the homeland, or with non-members of the group in the host land or elsewhere. So what's interesting about that is, quite honestly, the internet is something of a harbor welcoming immigrants every year, because all of us who share the internet share a simultaneous common space, cyberspace. And that is to say, it does not belong to any particular nation, state, or diasporic group. We've created the first commons. Since 2000, the global internet penetration and usage has grown to reach 30.2% of the Earth's 2011 population of 7 billion, and the numbers are growing quickly. In 2008, Twitter.com was logging 20 tweets per second, and this year they're logging 2,200 tweets per second, with over 18,000 search queries entered each second. So if the number of new internet users continues to grow in the same trajectory, it's going to quickly outpace the number of actual immigrants, refugees, and legalized economic workers crossing borders on an annual basis. Within these virtual diasporic groups, one's knowledge, community loyalty, cultural familiarity, and subject expertise can earn admittance and inclusion to online communities previously restricted to members of a specific nationality or ethnicity. Online, there appears to be an amicable, transactional mingling of participants from any nationality as long as they demonstrate enough familiarity and sophistication in their interests. So what constitutes enough knowledge? Quite honestly, that seems to depend on the forum in which they are engaged, and that changes frequently. Scholars have discursively broadened the use of the word transnational to encapsulate how the internet has grown to become supranational in its influence in so many ways, not only in dance. In 2009, scholars Bradaden, Poppin, and Melton articulated an accurate descriptor of this, stating, transnationalism is used here not as only beyond a nation or across state borders, but more powerful than national institutions and groups. So this is the world through the eyes of Facebook in 2010. Every point of light represents a user registered with Facebook. The arcs of light represent Facebook friendships. So you can see who is logged on and who is not at this point. And the migration of peoples have created movement syncretism and novel cultural manifestations for thousands of years, but the internet has transformed and impacted the way humans formulate individual identity, collective cultural memory, community norms, traditions, assimilation, and the expression of meaningful traditions. Examining cultural meaning and import through our use of the internet now permits a new window into the human dynamics of migration and cultural sharing, especially as how they relate to dance, elevating our analysis above past discussions of just anecdotal generalities. And further, our internet usage may continue to change the common definition of multiculturalism, as internet policy, regulation, security management, and public usage starts to instigate new norms in our expectations and online behaviors. Scholars such as Lisa Nakamura and Peter Chow White have been formulating questions and making astute observations about ethnicity, multiculturalism, and internet cybertyping on this very issue. So several tributaries of research have led me in my own investigations. So honestly, my own admission to the community was unobstructed by my previous background in another dance form, my economic standing, my gender, my multi-ethnic categorization. And addictively, my enthusiasm for information about my newfound passion could be easily matched by how fast my fingers could search the internet. So, given that this is a self-selected, voluntary group, Jennifer Brinkerhoff has a very good explanation about how voluntary groups operate. Low barriers to entry, low barriers to exit, and interpersonal relationships shaped by mutual adjustment rather than hierarchical authority or coercion. Why do we go online? Why do we use the internet? Most of us for work.
We also go there to seek or share useful information, to examine our own issues of sovereignty, individuation, and adaptation. We go there to mediate identity distress or geographic location. How many of you have picked up an interest and gone straight to the internet to see who else is out there doing what you want to do? Yes, of course. Of course you have, admit it. We go there to explore and evaluate the values and meaningful behaviors of our imagined peers. Maybe not our actual peers, but our imagined peers, the people we perceive ourselves to be connected to. And specifically, we go there to encounter novel information. We go seeking something interesting and new. Why do we use social networking? To mobilize around common interests or activities, to seek belonging and reciprocity, to negotiate the formation and importance of new cultural norms, ideas, and products through these self-regulating communities, to explore the benefits of our overlapping identities, because we may be parents, we may be scholars, we may be artists, we may do rock climbing, we may be sewers, we may do a whole number of things that evoke a different sense of personal identity. We go to self-publish objects of memory, personal videos, journals, photos, etc. And so, what captures our interest on the internet? How do things go viral? Professor Sinan Nirral elucidates some of the influences of what makes something go viral online. Does it have usefulness and functionality? Does it have relevance and topicality? Is it prominent? Can it have importance and observability in what we're seeing? Positive emotional connections, is it uplifting somehow? Unexpectedness and distinctiveness. And honestly, this is where when we start to feel ourselves identify with something we're seeing online, it's usually because we imagine ourselves experiencing the emotions and the elation or the interest or the humor that we're observing in that viral item. It's our overlapping identities that bring us to a new kind of global citizenship, especially in the transnational dance arts. Practitioners who are unapologetic about their enthusiasm for global citizenship beyond the entry-level novelties of just recreational travel and cuisine. They are art makers who revel in the abundance of information overload afforded by the internet. This flow of information is outpacing government and commercial efforts for monitoring or for regulation. The arena of the internet is now so large that national identity, arguably the dominant determinant of cultural identity, may be rendered less influential and meaningful over the common denominators such as religious ideology, sexual preference, art production. These are things that arguably affect the daily lives of individuals more possibly than the nation state in which they reside. Increasingly, incoming tribal fusion participants are informed by their own multi-heritage background or descendancy. It's worth noting that the growing number of multi-heritage citizens in the USA necessitated a change in census practices in 1990 after over 30 million people refused to categorize themselves as a single identity, choosing other as a classification rather than being pigeonholed into a single ethnic category. Reflecting this, the popularity of several multi-heritage tribal fusion artists indicates our community's acceptance and validation of traditional passages and practices and perspectives altered several degrees by generations through geographic relocation. How powerful is the influence of this voluntary, self-selected group of peers? Very powerful, because there is no central physical locale for tribal fusion. So virtual networks have come to be the host sites in between real-world gatherings. And the new concept of a virtual commons allows dancers to pool their resources, increase solidarity, power, visibility, and access. Again, returning to Jennifer Brinkerhoff, she emphasizes these are all gratifying tools in the effort to express one's identity and actualize a sense of self not validated within one's proximal community. More specifically, internet networking has allowed individuals to receive broad affirmation for socially peripheral interests and lifestyles. The strength of one's identification and loyalty within a digital tribe of common interests became an increasingly important variable in my own research. And dance isn't the only community experiencing changes attributed to the internet. the phenomenon of how technology is transforming human social organization and behavior is being examined very, very carefully. Dr. Sinan Aral, returning to him, has received over $36 million to advance his research in behavioral social contagion, mostly from the U.S. Army. And for those who log on, staying abreast of shifts in human customs takes a significant amount of energy and dedicated time, but it's this motivation that is central in maintaining our relevant connection through the internet and plugging in electronically. There's no question that the appeal of novel information and movements drive the level of immediacy in the tribal fusion community. What you're looking at is a visualization of George Takei from The Actor posting a comment online. This is a time-lapse video of about 20 minutes condensed into 1 minute, where you're watching the dark spots on the screen represent someone forwarding the information. As the thread goes dead, it turns to white. But you can see how the information continues and continues and continues. This rendering was done on George's account because he has over 2.5 million human beings following him on Facebook. I can't think of one popular dance group in the United States that has that many fans. I can't think of one politician that is able to amass that many hits on a given day, right?
He's so funny, though.
He's fantastic. Yeah, go to his site. You need a break in the day, go to his site. It's pretty fun. So things are happening quickly. Elias Aboujadeh alerts us to the speed at which transformations are happening in the digital diasporas and how behavioral and cultural norms surface in a self-regulating virtual community. He discusses the collapsing of cultural transference from a vertical line over several generations, which can usually take 15 to 25 years, collapsing to a horizontal plane whereby buzzworthy information goes viral worldwide within 1 week. So we've gone from cultural transference taking 20 years to 1 week to reach a tipping point of human population. This changes everything, everything. Specifically, one of the things that happens is it reduces the importance of elders and cultural transference. Rather than information being passed from elder to youngster, young people are informing each other as peers about what their cultural values are going to be. And even in the tribal fusion dance community, looking at the top 10 dance festivals that service over 500 constituents, out of 103 teachers, only 10 are over the age of 40. All of the headliners are in their 20s, except for old bats like me. So the commercial side of the community is comprised completely of youngsters, and there is no shortage of mature movers in Middle Eastern dance arts. We have Amel Tafsut, Morocco, Jamila Salimpour, Paula Reese Dennis, but they are simply not visible or active online in the same ways that keep them on the radar of younger participants and event organizers. So elders are left out of these internet exchanges, and who is left to provide the customary checks and balances that elders typically anchor in a society? Tradition and, oh gosh, how many things do our elders give us, and why are we not talking to them? Honestly, there is so much that viral sharing influences. It can be observed through data mining and studied as its own phenomenon, but there also exists a deeper issue of how much racial profiling and cultural imperialism may be encoded in the basic structure and logic of the internet because it favors Western organization and logic and sorts through Western models of logic and presentation. So some groups in history, we all know this, have often used technology to conjure validation for biological supremacy or economic dominance over others. So we need to examine these past patterns of how technological developments were deployed to enforce racial hierarchies. There are now notable similarities in how the basic coding, ordering, sorting, and logic behind the internet and operating platforms and code writing produce new inequities between the populations and genders. These initial partialities to culturally specific kinds of logic and organizational paradigms have favored our Western social systems and values, there's no doubt. The founders and finders are keepers mentality of the internet technology conflicts with the idea of equitable exchange. The digital divide is an attractive formulation because it promises an easy solution to a messy situation. It proposes that computer access in and of itself is a meaningful measure of informational power and privilege. But we all know that usage of the internet has not made us a more judicious, fair society by any means. Honestly, in our community, the vastness of the library on the internet is considered nearly common domain, and it has been in practice despite efforts at legislation. And the tribal fusion dancers seriously don't feel any remorse plagiarizing movements from YouTube, and perhaps that footage is of Egyptian dancers filmed by an Australian tourist. And the video's performer is so far removed from the tribal fusion dancer's local life, lessening the accountability required if they were directly acquainted. The ethics of the situation are not as salient because they're layered by several degrees of separation and require moral consideration of someone the tribal fusion dancer may not ever meet as an equitable collaborator in life. So honestly, our connectivity through technology does not guarantee integrity, especially in our dance community, in choreographic choices, in citation of sources. Yet many Americans are taking full credit for innovating a new dance form, revolution. So this digital divide is actually multiple divides with good and bad neighborhoods and users themselves envisioning the internet as containing ghettos with lower class populated and uneducated persons, potentially dangerous places to go, and positive places on the internet. That was also a point from Lisa Nakamura. Anyone can log on to see what's happening. And the formation of identity through self-regulating communities does not follow a linear path of evolution. And there are multiple reference points for importance and significant exchange between these pivotal influences. Personal objects of memory, such as scrapbooks, photo albums, journals, have migrated to the public arena and have become formative in creating entrainment amongst participants frequently by being forwarded virally online. For all of our current theories about connectivity, there is less discussion about the dehumanizing and isolating behaviors that humans must contend with when using machines to interact. The apparent indulgence of detaching our embodied selves from human exchange in the digital realm creates an interesting side effect in our consciousness. And specific to tribal fusion, the ability to self-select one's identity and cultural affinities and then actualize those interests in real-world gatherings isn't always utopian or beneficial in outcome. The internet's widely touted benefits for mobilization have a downside that may be problematic as our discourse progresses. Back to Elias Aboujadeh, he specializes in treating individuals whose lives are pathologically impacted or disrupted by internet usage, and he summarizes behaviors that are worthy of our consideration. Gradual erosion of inhibitions conditioned by the online anonymity. Active or deliberate reconfiguration of selfhood to a performed persona or virtual ethnicity. Delusions of grandeur, dissociated personhood or narcissism. I think these are all self-explanatory, so I'm not going into them. Impulsivity, and that's beyond gambling. It also deals with compulsive shopping or compulsive YouTubing, yes? Urge-driven and addictive behaviors. Disruption of memory formation, collective and personal. What does this mean? It means that if my performance tonight is photographed and posted on Facebook, and I go to see that photo of myself, every time I go to reference the event in my memory, chances are, instead of thinking about my own experience of dancing in front of you, I'm referencing the photos of me that were taken by someone else, and that becomes my dominant memory of the experience. So disruption of our memory. The illusion of knowledge. We all know that we skim quite a bit when we surf online. There is research that shows that when you go to read online, you're reading in an F formation. You will read across the top of the page from left to right. You will scan down the left side column for important bullets, hit mid-page, and then scan across from left to right. Meaning that with that scanning behavior, many people who are surfing are not acquiring depth of knowledge, but vast exposure without deep development or discursive conversation around the things they're looking at. So the question of dehumanization cannot be ignored. Walter Truitt Anderson posits an excellent analysis of this. Back in 1995, he said, "Pre-modern societies weren't necessarily simple or primitive, but people in them were relatively free from the culture shock experience of coming into contact with other people with entirely different values and beliefs, the kind of experience that in contemporary urban life, you're likely to have a couple of times before lunch. Postmodernity, then, is the age of overexposure to otherness, because in traveling, you put yourself in a different reality, because as the result of immigration, a different reality comes to you, and because with no physical movement at all, only the relentless and ever-increasing flow of information, cultures continue to interpenetrate. The enculturation process is aided and absolutely altered by virtual communities. And now, having sampled the vastness of information available on the internet, the tribal fusion community is starting to examine, unpack, and challenge the semiotics of the internet's visual culture and underlying organization. And in particular, there is a flavor of digital tourism to be scrutinized. Having coined the phrase cybertyping, Lisa Nakamura, since 2001, examines the ways that people perform their romanticized version of ethnicity online through avatars, nicknames, or language usage. The tribal fusion dancers often exploit Orientalist caricatures through online names such as Arabian Daughter, Queen of the Sahara, and actively conceal their real-world identities. And such stock stereotypes only strengthen regrettable and harmful prejudices, privileging participants to a level of agency reinforced and normalized by everyone else online doing the same darn thing. Jonathan Culler wrote about the semiotics of tourism and why there is general disregard for tourism, although travel itself is commonly lauded as a noble endeavor. He explains that a tourist, as opposed to a traveler, is perceived as a fantasist, equipped only temporarily with unaccustomed power. So online, it can initially be difficult to distinguish the visual presentations of dabblers from adepts, and there is no clear authority to establish benchmarks of proficiency. I do predict that this will change as we collectively mature through what is currently a cookie jar phase of internet discovery. We are now past the epoch of the technology's novelty. We are just starting to calm down, developing a healthy skepticism for our virtual partying ways. And I'm also observing an increase in the amount of public and media interrogation aimed at the commercial and military interests orchestrating our digital arena of exchange. This will continue to change and shift, but zooming out to analyze it is worthy at every single stage of the development of our internet usage. Of course, there's so many questions I have for future research. And so many of them center around, first, capturing what has happened in this transformation. As I announced earlier, John Compton died this week, and I've already missed the opportunity to capture his original statements as one of the innovators. But other things that come up in the research, how has the digital diaspora affected thresholds of cultural tolerance and discourse between dance participants? How has the immediacy and abundance of internet video modified the agency individuals employ in approaching the unfamiliar in their lives? Within Middle Eastern cultures that condone public secular dance, what are common responses to the West's remixing of their dances or counter-manifestations of fusion dance within Arab societies? I have so many questions that I continue to research. But look at new directions that are starting to happen in the digital dance arena. Daniels on his spot, sponsored by Samsung for the release of their new Galaxy phone. And this is one of the forms we talked about early in the presentation, finger tutting. Finger tutting, when I researched it back in 2009, had 6 YouTube results on the internet, now 9,350 YouTube results. And Julian himself has received over 7 million hits on the internet. So honestly, my research can barely keep up with what's happening, but I enjoy conversing with all of you about what you've seen out there online, what you bump into, and what questions you have. So I'm going to not drag you through any more of my research and just say thank you so, so much for attending tonight. Thank you very, very much to our sponsors for this evening and the Association of Diplomacy Scholars for trying something new and bringing, oh my goodness, a dancer into the arena. I hope that I didn't ruffle your feathers too much. And if you have some questions of myself and Dr. Beeman, we'd be very excited to hear from you. If you do need to take off, thank you so much for your generosity tonight. Yes.
Donna, this is for you. Since you know we're going to DC, do you know of any place in DC where I could learn to do that?
Can I break decorum and say, hell yeah. Absolutely. The Sahara Dance Studio is a good epicenter, and there are a variety of wonderful people operating in DC. I'll get you those links. Introduce you over Facebook. Other questions? No? Thank you. Enjoy your evening, and we'll see you soon. Mm.